An idea born in unsettled times.
We are going forward. America, the United States, is first in space.
Becomes a feat of engineering excellence. The most complex machine ever built. To bring humans to and from space.
Roger, roll, Discovery.
And eventually, construct the next stop on the road to space exploration.
We are on a true spaceship now.
As 30 years of flight draw to a close, its legacy is one of unsurpassed achievement. Tragedy overcome and opportunity met. NASA Space Shuttle. Space Shuttle Endeavour is rolling out to Launch Pad 39A at NASA's Kennedy Space Center in Florida. In 24 missions, flown over 20 years, Endeavour has logged more than 103 million miles in space. The last of NASA shuttles to be built, Endeavour prepares for her final flight, STS-134.
I marvel at when I see the space shuttle up close and personal, behind the panels where we have hardware, plumbing, black boxes, electronic devices and that sort of thing. The workmanship that I see in this is astounding. And that points right at the people that do this. When you integrate all that together, it results in what I think has been a marvelous program with the space shuttle.
Well before any shuttle reaches the launch pad, however, a staggering amount of work is required. The parts, plans, and people necessary to make each launch span the entire nation. One single goal is the focus, the safety of the orbiter and her crew.
You've got all these people, all these folks that are in their 20s, some of them in their 30s, and they are, no kidding, in charge of some part of the space shuttle, some part of the space station, or some part of the plan, and every one of those people absolutely believes that they are the one that makes the difference on getting those astronauts back down to the ground alive.
At NASA's Mission Assembly Facility in New Orleans, production begins on the shuttle's external fuel tank. The last of 136 produced here since 1973. Each one, 154 feet tall and 27.6 feet around, is capable of handling 535,000 gallons of liquid hydrogen and oxygen, enough to fill 13,375 average household bathtubs. Three versions of the external tank were created during the program in an effort to reduce the tank's overall weight and allow for heavier shuttle payloads. Around the same time, in Clearfield, Utah, technicians at ATK Launch Systems start work on the shuttle system's solid rocket motors, or boosters.
Fire.
Together, these SRBs produce nearly 6 million pounds of thrust, about 83% of the thrust needed to push the orbiter into space. The remaining 17% is furnished by the shuttle's three main engines, fueled by the external tank. Unlike the orange external tank that is used only once, the boosters detach themselves and parachute into the Atlantic Ocean. They are then retrieved, refurbished, and reused on later missions. The shuttle mission's crew is assigned.
Folks on there that are like my brothers and sisters. I mean, we really do get close after a year of training for a flight and having flown in space together. And there's a special bond that comes with that.
Right up until launch, a shuttle crew will train in a variety of critical regimens, some basic, others specific to their mission. Simulators, safety and contingency, science experiments, and underwater in the world's largest indoor pool. STS-134 astronauts floating in actual spacesuits train to work during extravehicular activities, or EVAs. The Neutral Buoyancy Lab, or NBL, at NASA's Johnson Space Center in Houston is the best simulation of microgravity on Earth, an ideal for practicing spacewalks.
One of the most amazing facilities that we work in is the NBL, the Neutral Buoyancy Lab, and the divers and the guys who help us run the robotic arm are all there to ensure that our spacewalks are flawless. Their efforts in that pool have helped us and made us able to have this program.
Every step of a spacewalk, every step of EVA is so critical, and even though we see it every day, that's what that one little safety tether could be life or death.
For every hour that they spend in orbit, they'll spend 5 to 6 hours training for that same task. So we've built up from the suit engineers and suit technicians who help them get into the suit. Now we've got trainers who help them learn how to use the suit and learn how to understand the suit. And then we've got divers who support them while they're in the pool. The closer they get to actually flying in the suit, the team of people who help them tends to grow, maybe not exponentially, but it's certainly getting bigger.
A 12-person crew has kept a week-long vigil, while the barge, carrying the ET, made the 900-mile trek from Louisiana to Florida's central east coast. The iconic orange external tank finally arrives at the Kennedy Space Center. 1 month later, the ET is mated to the solid rocket boosters to form the backbone of the stack. Now, all that's missing is the spacecraft itself. When an orbiter returns from a mission, processing for the next flight begins almost immediately. It's a task requiring no less than 650,000 hours of labor. This includes the removal of its three liquid fuel engines and their replacement by three from a previous mission. They've been refurbished, inspected, and tested at the Stennis Space Center. With most of its flight preparations complete, Endeavour is towed in what is called the rollover, a short roll over a quarter-mile distance on a 36-wheeled vehicle from the Orbiter Processing Facility, the OPF, to the VAB. Here it undergoes its flight configuration. The rollout. Looking now much like it will at liftoff, the space shuttle is carried to the launch pad atop the 6-million-pound crawler transporter at a blazing pace of less than a mile an hour. Not exactly warp speed.
At our peak carrying full load, we get right around 38 feet per gallon.
Not too bad for an original 1965 hybrid vehicle with low miles. The 3.4-mile journey takes up to 6 hours. Just enough time to appreciate the route's picturesque surroundings. Kennedy Space Center is situated on a national wildlife refuge. Bald eagles, osprey, and vultures are just a few of the scores of bird species regularly spotted in local skies. Both land and sea are home to a wide variety of creatures, including manatees, dolphins, and of course, the ever-present alligator. Visitors are always urged to watch their step. Now on the launch pad, the orbiter is ready to take on its main payload. Testing assures that the multi-ton cargo is secured and safely stowed in the payload bay before the technicians certify the orbiter is ready for launch. Flying T-38 aircraft from Ellington Field in Houston, the crew members arrive at Kennedy's shuttle landing facility.
But finally the day comes when you're there and you're getting ready to launch. And you go into launch countdown and it's like going up the hill on that roller coaster. It's full of expectation. And you're both thrilled and terrified at the same time, because anything could go wrong, but when it goes right, it's a thing of beauty.
If there are no issues or concerns, technicians begin fueling the external tank with volatile liquid hydrogen and oxygen.
The predominant emotion is pride. There's a tremendous sense of pride in all that, that not only that you do, but that your teammates do, that people in this very firing room do, and folks all across the country.
This is Shuttle Launch Control, T-minus 9 minutes.
At the T-minus 9 minute hold, the launch director leads one final pull.
We finally come out of the hold at T-minus 9 minutes. I sit back and I watch my data, but I know that there are souls on board that ship that, whose lives are depending on the launch team to make the right decisions.
It's,
I don't think about that consciously. The decision-making authority and responsibility, I know it's there, but I do think consciously about the crew and the people we're about to put on top of a controlled explosion and get to orbit.
This is the NTD conducting the launch status check. All stations verify ready to resume count and go for launch. OTC, OTC go. TVC, TVC go. ETC, ETC's go. LPS, LPS is go. Houston flight.
Houston flight is go.
After nearly 3 years, hundreds of thousands of hours logged by engineers, technicians, scientists, seamstresses, electricians, and other program workers across the globe.
We have main engine start. 2, 1. Booster ignition.
The shuttle makes its way skyward. At liftoff, 6.6 million pounds of thrust begin hurtling the vehicle and crew at speeds that'll reach 17,500 miles per hour. The shuttle is like no other machine ever built. For its launch to succeed, more than a million parts must move together perfectly. How this engineering marvel came to be is an amazing story that begins in the early 1970s. The Vietnam War is divisive and costly. The economy is sliding into recession. And with the race to the moon already won, the Apollo program is canceled. A new mission is sought for NASA to send humans into space. But Mars, for many the next logical step on the path of exploration, is dismissed as too costly, a destination for a country preoccupied with events back on Earth. Instead, on January 5th, 1972, another destination is selected, low Earth orbit. As early as the mid-1960s, NASA had concluded that the technology was available to build and fly a reusable spacecraft.
President Nixon really liked the idea and told the NASA administrator, go do it. And the NASA administrator got a call from OMB the next morning, someone there, and said, hey, what the president really meant to say was, you're going to get this much money, and so do as best you can with the space transportation system. And our choice, logically, was you have to have a vehicle first, and so that was the birth of the space shuttle as the first in the three-part space transportation system.
Many designs were considered. Often, they combined the best features of different concepts.
At that time, they were looking at having jet engines on the shuttle for landing and for transporting it across the country.
The idea of the lifting bodies was to bring astronauts home to conventional runway landing. Previously, all of our spacecraft, which were capsules, came down in the ocean. Someone came up with the idea of a vehicle that could land like an airplane.
The key thing was to understand aerodynamic stability across the hypersonic, supersonic, subsonic, and landing speed type of environments that a single vehicle has to fly safely. That was the key thing that was learned from those, and you'll see it reflected in the shape of the space shuttle.
One was the use of a lifting body, an aircraft with no conventional wings. Only its fuselage would keep the aircraft airborne and guide it safely back to Earth.
They were known as the flying bathtubs. For the first test, the M2F1 was towed behind a car, souped-up Pontiac. Whitey Whitesides drove that Pontiac across the lake bed at about 120 miles per hour, dragging this flying bathtub behind it.
As well as groundbreaking, their tests could also prove ground shaking. The X-24B, a lifting body with wings, was the first such craft to land on an actual runway, as all shuttles would eventually do.
Early on, the space shuttle was going to have jet engines to return for a horizontal landing, much like an airliner. The X-15 had proven fairly specifically that they could make horizontal landings very accurately, unpowered, flying a steep glide slope, that they could do a horizontal, unpowered landing with the shuttle.
As they tried to narrow its size, shape, and weight, engineers also considered how this new orbiter would be propelled safely out of the reach of Earth's gravity. At the Marshall Space Flight Center in Huntsville, home of the rockets that had sent every Mercury, Gemini, and Apollo astronaut into space.
All engine running. Liftoff, we have a liftoff.
Design teams would devise the partially reusable propulsion system that would finally be adopted.
The main engines were always something we paid very close attention to. Lots of moving parts, lots of high energy in very tight places, and very cold liquid on one side of a very small wall and very hot on the other side. When that thing finally lit off, for me, it just showed the power of a space shuttle main engine, and then there's three on the back of an orbiter, and then there's the two solid rocket motors. That was probably the spark that got me so interested in the space shuttle program in general, and what it took to actually get one engine to light, much less three and two boosters to take the shuttle to orbit.
As for the orbiter, spiraling costs forced NASA to abandon equipping it with its own jet engines and escape pod.
Originally, it was going to be an air-breathing airplane that would fly to space as a rocket and then come back to Earth. The orbital maneuvering system pods that sit on the back now were to be where deployable air-breathing engines would come out, and it would be able to fly from its intended point of landing to another place if the weather were bad or something like that.
NASA's new shuttle would essentially glide its way back to Earth. Producing the components of this new space transportation system fell to familiar names in the space industry. Prime contractor Rockwell North American, now Boeing, had built the Apollo Command Service Module. Morton Thiokol, now ATK, would build the solid rocket boosters. And Martin Marietta, now Lockheed Martin, would construct the ET. Responsibility for producing the space shuttle's main engines went to Rocketdyne, now Pratt Whitney.
There was a lot of teamwork that was going on. It was bringing people from all across the country, from Kennedy, from Johnson, from Marshall. So many people involved that had to have worked together. Now, at the beginning, there was a lot of anxiety that we weren't going to work together. But when people got to know each other and could trust each other, that's when the work began.
It was an amazing vehicle, in a lot of ways way ahead of its time, to have a reusable spacecraft that could carry such tremendous amounts of cargo to space was unprecedented.
September 1976, more than 4.5 years after President Nixon signed off on its development, America's new spacecraft, Constitution, gets its first close-up before the cameras. The orbiter itself was well-received by the public, but impassioned fans of a particular long-canceled television series called Star Trek wanted it called something else. They staged a successful write-in campaign, and the orbiter was renamed for the Starship, featured on the show. Thus, NASA's new shuttle would be the Enterprise, boldly going as no spacecraft had ever gone before. Whatever its name, this bird still needed to prove it could fly. In an age before computer simulations, balsa wood models and wind tunnel testing was the only means to test the airliner-sized glider.
We put together a very aggressive flight test profile that consisted of data points continuously all the way down. There was not a matter of 10 seconds went by without another either pitch doublet or a rudder kick or an angle of attack sweep. The things that really turn on a test pilot to fly them as accurately as possible.
August 12, 1977, on a crystal clear California morning, high above the Mojave Desert, two NASA test pilots ready for Enterprise's first flight. The plan was for Fred Hayes, Jr. and Gordon Fullerton to lift the orbiter off a modified 747, then land on a dry lake bed 15,000 feet below.
The thing that we were most concerned about was if we were going to be able to get to a launch speed, if Fitz Fulton was going to be able to put the 747 into a slight dive so that we would have enough lift on the Enterprise to, when we did push the separation button, blow the bolts, to lift away from the airplane without hitting Fitz's tail. And of course, both of us were interested in that happening.
The pilots on the 747, Fitz Fulton and Tom McMurtry, sit and wait for the command to release and steer their massive aircraft out from under Enterprise.
There were still questions about, was it going to actually happen as we expected from those simulations and the analysis and everything. There's a very loud thump when the shuttle separates. There was always a question, was the shuttle going to slide back and hit the tail of the 747? But we couldn't see that, but we could, after a few seconds, we could tell it didn't hit us. And so the chase called clear.
Once we reached the 240 knots and Fitz called on speed, I think he really pushed some of the sensors he was looking at in order to let us get to there, and we appreciated that. But once we heard Fitz say on speed, I pushed the separation button and we just broke free. We had about 1.5 G's of lift.
Honestly, that was probably the most exciting moment in the approach and landing test, to feel and be there when the shuttle separated from the 747.
By all accounts, this first freefall test is a success. 5 weeks later, Enterprise is brought to 22,000 feet for her second freefall test. Pilots Joe Engel and Dick Truly have only 2 minutes to capture flight and maneuvering data before landing the aircraft again without any engine.
It was a real team effort, and the challenge was for Dick Truly and I to fly that profile and fly those data points, those maneuvers, as precisely as possible to give them the best data possible. It was a test pilot's dream.
A total of 16 taxi, captive, and drop tests confirmed the soundness of the craft's design and green-lighted production of the first spaceworthy orbiter.